That. Okay, so I did send you a copy of the financial statement, and for Mr. Mayor Peasy's suggestion, we're going to be keeping a log of the variances that we've already addressed, and I will add to it every month. So you had that to review. I don't know if you have any questions. You had 20 warrants to sign tonight, totaling $1,415,424.86. And that's it for the financial report.
Anybody have any questions for Patty? Quick questions?
Industrial arts, the red 20 grand, did we talk about that before?
Yes, it's going to correct itself because where we budgeted and then where various assigned teachers changed, so.
So we're going to 6D, we're going here, 6D now?
So there's 20,000 to the plus on the other line. But I'm going to correct it.
I didn't know. I'm not going to go through and ask any more questions.
You can send them to me via email, I mean, have them come in and see me anytime.
Anybody else have any other questions? We're going to go to the budget. So we're now going to jump to to unfinished business, 6D, further discussion on the proposed FY18 budget, while Pat's here. And I'm going to turn it over to the chair, Bill.
Okay, we were supposed to have this discussion a week and a half ago, but Mother Nature had other ideas a couple of times. So here we are again. We scheduled this extra meeting, so I see there were some questions that showed up for Patty in the interim, and those questions were answered. We wanted to have another opportunity for all of us to sit with this thing before we ask you to vote on it. So Patty's got the assessment numbers this time, which we didn't have last time. We've been working with them since 5 o'clock. Looking at the assessment numbers, we haven't digested them much, but at least we have them. So we have all the pieces of the puzzle for all of you now. And I don't think we're going to be at the point where we'll be able to take a vote tonight. We're already scheduled for the 28th anyway, to meet. So that would seem to be the sensible time to do the actual vote. But we can certainly get all the rest of it done.
Okay. Have it. Thank you. So I'm going to just tell you, starting on page 1 of 32, that the only thing that's changed on this page is projected enrollment. The data for October 1st enrollment on the top, I leave that as is because that is what our foundation enrollment is going to be. But on the 18 projection, I am changing that as the Frontier population changes. So it's not going to, you're not going to see it exact. So that's the only difference I made there. Right now, in our latest enrollment report, there are 145 sixth graders in our 4 elementary. 30 of them are school choice from other districts. We don't normally get all of them. So we're waiting to see what will fall out. Mr. Modesto
has... The other number is the tech school. The tech school out of the ninth grade class hasn't been pulled yet. They're 10 to 15 is what they use.
So that'll go down. As a side note, Mr. Modesto, some of our towns are asking if we've had any Smith Volk requests so they can plan for their budgets for Smith Volk.
Yep, and I have not heard of any.
Okay, that would be great.
That we know.
All right.
Those are expensive.
Okay, so then on page 2 of 32, we have our summary. Two lines have changed since the budget you saw before. The increase in the retirement buyback in the previous version was at 27,000. It's now at 33,041. We had to do some recalculations. And then the decrease in the tuitions changed to a credit of $31,071, still leaving us at 3%. So all the detail lines have remained the same as they flow up. And one of the questions that had been asked was, we use the word other expenses and other salaries. These are the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education. This is their chart of accounts, and this is how we fill out the end of the year report. So that is, as far as our goal, was to get our chart of accounts to resemble theirs so that you guys can look at your monthly budget and then look at your end of the year report, and it would be the same. So I understand
the
word about the other.
Thank you for answering that question. Yeah, I was concerned about other and being too general, but I appreciate it.
And with salaries, it's professional, clerical, and other. So you were either a teacher, a secretary, or everybody else. Now we can skip to page 15 of 32. And to this page, I've added now the governor's projection for our school choice and charter. So we were looking at the, in FY '17, we were going to have a deficit of $69,788. The preliminary numbers after our October 1st, it now looks like we're going to be right side up $348,831. We have not budgeted any money towards that, so that will all be available in FY '18. On the right is the governor's budget, and from their numbers, it looks like we'll be up $199,151, which will also be available for expenditure in '18, giving us a budget of $547,982. On our budget sheet, we have a recommendation to use $150,000 of school choice money and take salaries off the assessment to the towns. So we would use that in '18. If you would turn the page to 16 of 32, this is our circuit breaker account. Circuit breaker is the money we get when we spend more than the norm for a special education student. This money has been pretty, this reimbursement has been very useful to us because we've had some high costs out of district placements. And what we've done with this money is funded programs to stop the out of district, and we've built capacity here at Frontier. We've also built capacity at our elementary level. So right now there are no elementary students in any of the four schools that go to out of district. They're all housed in our programs. So they need to come up to programs. So we had to build the programs here, and we were using circuit breaker money to do that. Now the out of district placements, some of them very expensive ones, have aged out. So our reimbursement is lower. But we still need these salaries to fund these special programs. So because of that, we're going to be short about $113,914. So if you go back to 15, the recommendation would be to use the school choice money to cover that shortfall. So in FY 18, we would be spending $263,914 and be left with a balance of $284,068 in case we get any move-ins or in Mr. Modesto has stated to us that if he gets a certain number of seventh graders, if we ended up with like 140 seventh graders, we would need an additional middle school teacher. So that would leave us some room there to add that teacher, should that come to fruition.
Plus that circuit breaker thing is going to recur again, right?
It's going to continue to go down.
Down, because our ODPs are disappearing.
Right. So if we don't do it, if we don't right side it this year, we're going to have to take a bigger hit next year.
What's the percentage at right now that we get paid on over what, 30 or 40,000 on circuit breaker? What's the percentage about?
It's in the governor's budget. It's at 70% over $43,094.
So it's over 43 now.
Yes.
Before it was 30.
It was like 29. 30, yeah, it's up to 43. So.
But we get 70.
70% of over the overage, if that is what it goes through all the legislature. Okay, 17 of 32, our excess and deficiency was certified by the Department of Revenue on February 2nd at $342,100. We had already taken a vote to use $28,000, but that vote was invalid, so we need to revote that. I don't know if you want to do that tonight or if you want to put it on March's agenda and do it.
No, put it on March.
Okay. So that leaves us available excess and deficiency funds of $314,100. All right, now we're going to skip to the assessment section, which starts on page 25 of 32. So in order to determine the assessments, we have to look at our enrollment. So we are dropping out, it's a five-year average, we're dropping out 2011 when we had 539 students, and we're bringing in 2016 with 467 students. So with that being said, Conway's percentage is going to increase to 1586, Deerfield's 4851, Sunderland 2373, and Waitley 11.9. Page 26, we're looking at our revenue. So this year we assessed to the town $7,305,203. Next year, we would be assessing them $7,738,892. That is up $433,689. A large part of the increase is, if you look below, the minimum contributions set by the state are reduced $230,995. So that is why the increase is so high. Chapter 70, we were allotted $20 per student additional revenue for totaling $11,020. Excess and deficiency, the school committee has not allocated any E&D because we hadn't had it certified. Our regional transportation money is projected to go down $61,308. And our revolving transportation fund is up $8,018. So page 27 is the page from DESE that shows the minimum contribution for the towns being reduced and the total amount of the foundation enrollment by town that gives them that decrease. And then page 28 is the assessment. So we take the operating budget, which is less the transportation, we apply the Chapter 70, and that leaves us $7,623,248. We then take those assessments, the minimum contributions, totaling $4,621,267, leaving us $3,001,981 to assess to the towns based on the 5-year rolling average. So when we do that and add that to the minimum contribution, that is what the total assessments are for ed reform. And then just so that you can compare, we have the assessment for the regional agreement, and the difference if we had used the regional agreement versus the ed reform formula.
Towns haven't got this yet, correct?
No.
Okay.
They will get it tomorrow morning.
Okay.
They've all called for it.
Yeah, I would imagine they have.
29 of 32, this is the combined assessment of the operating with the transportation. This used to be 3 layers because we had the debt assessment, but that's gone away. So you can see the combined assessments are increasing 5.94% or $433,690. Conway would go up 12.07%, Deerfield 5.48%, Sunderland 3.65%, and Waitley 4.18%. Page 30 is just this is how I know that our budget's in balance. I take the operating budget plus the transportation budget, so we have our total budget, and then I look at our funding sources, and the two numbers are in balance. Our funding sources equal our budget, so we know we're even. Page 31 to 32, this is how we're allocating the regional transportation. So our budget of transportation this year is $277,962. The regional transportation, we estimate at 50%, even though the percent in the governor's budget is higher, for conservative factors and to be free of 9C cuts, we always use at least the most 50%. And it's not 50% of our FY18 budget, it's 50% of what was reported as actually spent in FY16. So that's why it says 50%, but it's not 50% of the $277,962. So the difference is what we assess to the towns based on their 18 assessment, and then we establish the Regional Transportation Revolving Fund. We have $54,641 from FY16, so the towns get credited at their 16 assessment rate, so they're getting back the same amount of dollars that they put in. And that's how we get the assessment for regional transportation.
Which is on the good side.
Pardon?
If they're getting money back, that's on the good side.
Right, they're getting a credit. And then page 32 of 32 is the a compilation of all the different percentages that we're using for the different budgets. So, Mr. Smith, do you want to take it from here and,
yep,
and discuss what we discussed?
Yep. As I say, the budget subcommittee started looking at these numbers at 5 o'clock when we came in. We batted this around. There's a couple different ways of approaching this thing. What we What we attempted to do is to lower the assessments a little bit without having a great impact on everything else that's happening around here, because as we're gonna have a nice chat with Mr. Lesko later on, he's gonna want some money, and there's some other things going on that are gonna require some funding. So we needed to do some things here to make the whole thing fit together. If you go back to 29 of 32, the assessment page, what the budget subcommittee is recommending to the entire committee is that, if you remember, the AED was at $314,100 or something to that effect. We're recommending that you take one half of that, the AED, apply it towards the assessment. Now those numbers on the, I'll just give you the number on the bottom, the percentage number changes, Conway's changes. If you apply $157,000 in E&D to your assessments, your Conway's assessment is now 9.93%, Deerfield's is 3.32, Sunderland's is 1.47, and Whately's is 2.13. Having said that, we know that there are things here that have to be done upstairs. We'll talk about that later, the cost of the job upstairs, but what the budget subcommittee is recommending that you do is take the 157, apply it to the assessments, and take whatever costs are involved in the repair efforts, put them on a separate article. Let them stand on their own merit. They're not a true budget. It's not a true budget item because it's not a recurring expense. It doesn't belong in here because it makes the figures crazy next year, because it really doesn't belong in here. If you're going to spend $150,000 to fix something upstairs, it doesn't belong here because it's not a recurring expenditure. So we're going to let that stand on its own merit. We're trying to make this particular budget as palatable assessment-wise. We're going to maintain 3% budget, but as you know, if you've been here any more than 10 minutes, assessments and budgets numbers never match because of foundation, state formula, and all of that stuff. By the time you figure that out together, say, well, if it's only a 3% budget, why is my assessment up 9.9? Minimum contribution, foundation budget, all of that stuff factors into it, and we all know that. So that's what we're recommending that you do, is take the 157 and apply it, and then your total assessment increase becomes 3.79 rather than 5.94.
And Mr. Smith, I would like to know the results of that, because at least the towns are going to be barking for this tomorrow morning. So if that is the plan to apply the 157 with the warrant article, I need to adjust this and I get it out to them. Mm-hmm. So with that being said, you can all just fill me in tomorrow.
Yep. Can you do that?
There's extra budgets here in case anybody comes in. Mm-hmm.
Well, I mean, I don't. Well, maybe you are. I don't know if the committee's ready to vote on final budget.
No.
I don't think you are. But we just need some. You need some consensus amongst the however many of 11 of us are here, 10 of 11 or 9 of 9
of
11.
That's the plan.
That's the plan. So Patty can prepare the paperwork and let it fly, because they're going to be. She's got a. Lynn has a meeting at 2:00 tomorrow afternoon with the town administrators, and they want to have this before they get here, basically. That's the only.
What was the consensus of the your subcommittee on the 157?
Mary left. She had to leave. She gave us her opinion before we took a vote. The vote was 3-0, but Mary's opinion was the same. Okay. She wasn't present for the vote, so we didn't record it as 4-0. We recorded it as 3-0. But Mary Raymond's was the same. Her consensus was the same. That 3% is not, given what's happened to Blue, especially health insurance, 3% is not. It's not that difficult to live with. So we tried to make the assessments a little bit easier for the towns to live with by taking some of the E&D. It's a gamble, because having 150 left in E&D for an operation, for a $10 million operation, is not a lot of money. But we can't afford to keep it. We've got to use it to lower the assessments, because the towns need the relief. So we do the best we can. You don't want to take any more than that. It wouldn't be prudent to raid that any more than that, but we could take 150.
And what was the balance on the school choice money for next year?
Find it. 354?
That was 314.
314?
I've got page 50.
Do I hear another number?
Yeah,
just 15. So the balance is 284, what we have?
Yeah, it started at 3... And then she's taking some of it to pay some of the teaching salaries in the regular budget and to offset the circuit breaker loss, so that what's going to remain in there is 284. 284.
So basically, out of the 284 that's there, what would be the census of, what do we use that for? We use it for rainy day fund, right? Just in case something comes up?
Yep, for a couple of scenarios, and we've had them happen before. An out-of-district placement, somebody moves into to any one of the four towns that goes to school on an ed plan, and you know what some of those tuitions are like. You know, because that's what's causing the loss of circuit breaker money. Those two especially have aged out of Frontier. They were very expensive placements. They've aged out. So we're not paying for them anymore, so we're not getting the circuit breaker
money. So what's the 150 that we have left over then? Is the 150 for a rainy day fund too, just in case something happens, right? The 150 in E&D?
In E&D.
Yes.
So you're going to combine them?
So, you know, no. If 284 is for a rainy day fund and the 150 is for a rainy day fund, can we take a little bit more from the 150 than the 157 and put another 50 in to bring the assessment down a little bit for the towns?
Well, there's certain.
I'm just asking.
Yeah, there's certain things you can do and certain things you can't. Probably the better scenario in that situation is would be to take more of the school choice money to replace items in the budget and lower the assessment and leave it in the E&D, because their access to the E&D is different than regular budget. Access to the E&D, the four towns have to agree on access to the E&D. So whereas inside the budget they don't.
Right.
So where you take it from, same amount of money, but it's a different. It's a different mechanism.
I just didn't
to
know
get
if,
the money.
You know, if we took 157 to bring it down, can we take any of it, either one of these, and bring it down? I mean, I'm just asking. I like the rainy day fund. I've always believed it from day one for Whately.
If you know me, you know I don't fool around. I'll tell you the God's honest truth. And what absolutely has to be done here is that we're putting the capital article on a stand on its own merit.
Right.
What happens if it fails? That thing leaks. And we're not going to take the $40,000 or $45,000 that Mr. Mark gave us, put new carpets and furniture in there, and have them get wet. So we have to have a contingency plan if that capital article doesn't pass, because that has to be fixed. So
I agree there, and I think that we need to build some goodwill here too by.
That's why we.
By putting this.
That's why we didn't keep it all the E&D. We used some to reduce the assessments, but we don't want to raise either one of those, the school choice number or the E&D anymore, because if that doesn't fly. Where are we? You got to fix it. You can't just go, oh, well, it didn't pass. Get another 5-gallon bucket and stick it in the hallway upstairs. That ain't going to work. So, to be frank and honest with you, that's part of the reason we didn't rate it any more than it was.
I'm a firm believer in having a rainy day fund, but if we have two good sized rainy day funds, do we tap into either one of them to bring the assessment down
actually,
a little bit more? I mean, that's all.
Actually, we should be holding at least 5% back.
State law allows us to keep 5% of our budget. I've been here almost 40 years, we've never done that. Never have it. You don't have it to keep. 5%? Would that be nice?
But the other thing is, if you get a bunch more kids going to charter school,
it's
going to come in out of there.
Like we were last year, we were upside down because charter and choice didn't, what was coming in didn't match up what was going out. So
if I don't ask the question, other people will.
We've got to watch the back door to some degree.
I
mean,
all questions are welcome.
I like the rainy day fund just for emergency purposes, but you know, it sounds like we have two of them. In Whately, we only have one. We had school choice for a rainy day fund. Hey, let's keep 50,000 just in case we have a problem. Here, we have two, and that's.
But we thought, I mean, given the budget at 3%, we thought this was a pretty good compromise. Yeah. It helps the assessment numbers a little bit, but it also protects the back door, so to speak. So.
Do we have to vote on the 157 tonight for Patty, or get a census?
I think if we,
you got two members that are missing. I don't know if you want to wait till next.
No, we have to do something tonight to go forward.
We have to give Patty the green light to be able to, and Lynn the green light to be able to create the numbers for them, guys.
But does it have to be, I'm sorry.
No, I was just going to say, since the subcommittee has already voted for that as a recommendation, does it need to be a vote from the entire committee to agree with such, or?
It should be if we're going to.
You don't have to vote the final budget figure because the two things have nothing to do with it.
I'm just talking about moving the 157 to take care of the lowering our assessments to the town.
That motion, you can make a motion to move $157,050 from E&D to reduce the assessments to the towns for the FY18 budget. They haven't been voted yet, the FY18 budget, but whatever it is, you're going to reduce it by $157,000.
Well, Do I have a second?
You have a second.
Okay, further discussion. Do I have anybody that would like to put any comments into Bill that are disagreeing with the situation?
You get where I'm going with that?
You're voting on one but not the other, because one, that 157 happens regardless. If you decided in 2 weeks from now, we don't want a 3% budget, we want a 4% budget, you're still gonna apply 150, so it doesn't make any difference. But I don't think you wanna vote a final budget figure yet.
All those in favor? Opposed?
Was it unanimous?
Yeah.
Okay.
Great. So I'm going to give this information to Patty, and she will change the assessment information in this packet before she sends it to the four towns.
And then she can have that conversation with the...
Yes, sir.
Is she speaking with tomorrow?
Tom did.
I am.
Okay, you are. Okay, so you now have that information to share with them.
Yep.
Okay, thank you.
So that'll become budget version number 3.
Well, that's okay. I've been at 3, and have a good one.
At least 3.
Thank you so much for all your hard work, the whole budget committee. Been there, done that. Glad I'm not there. Glad somebody is.
Hey, Bill, give me those numbers later on, the new numbers on the assessment, so I can put it in.
Yep. Yeah, we got them. No problem.
We gonna do the minutes next?
Nope.
Madam Chair?
No, we're gonna take care of...
No, we're going to...
That wonderful looking...
Why don't we disapprove the minutes?
Get them out of here, because they don't want to listen anymore of this stuff.
We're gonna jump.
Johnny fell asleep twice already.
Okay, the person who is taking the minutes has requested that we not jump too much. So we will go back and do
next thing you want to raise.
Review and approve of the minutes from January 24th first, if you can...
Did you put a raise in the budget form?
Be patient.
You should have.
See, and you thought it was gonna be a boring...
No, don't worry. You're fine.
I need a motion to approve the minutes.
So...
I need a second.
I will second.
Thank you. I need discussion. Anyone have anything?
Thank you.
All those in favor? Opposed? Anybody have to abstain? Can't see. Are you good?
Feel bad.
Okay, everybody's good? Okay, we're good to go. Bob's happy. Now we will jump ahead again to new business, a school resource officer for Frontier Regional School District. Sirs.
Where would you like to start, Cindy?
Here we're going
to have a conversation.
You
want me to get questions, or do you want me to describe what's going on?
Yeah, explain what's going on, a little bit of the history, and what we're asking for.
Sure. So most of you know me. My name's John Pachorik. I'm the chief of police in Deerfield. I came back. This is my hometown about 4.5 years ago. My two kids are at Deerfield Elementary. My daughter's 7, and my son's 9 years old. And when I came back, I've always been very community-oriented. I ran the Police Explorer program here since I was 16 years old, on and on and on. I was a little taken back by our relationship as an agency with the student body across town. Now, if you study Deerfield, you know, obviously we have 5 schools. So we range between 2,200 and 2,500 kids on a daily basis in those 5 schools. In Sturbridge, at Tantasqua Regional High School, we had 6 towns, 1,400 kids in grades 9 through 12, and they were ecstatic to see me on a daily basis. They would come up with me, they would interact with me, and my first visit here was with Marty Barrett as the principal of Frontier. And the minute I walked in the door, I heard kids talking, "Oh God, why are they here?" And I went, that is not the relationship we want. See, I'm a firm believer that we get kids in the elementary school for 6, 7, 8 years, depending on kindergarten, preschool, you get them in high school, in junior high for an additional 6 years, but then what happens is we inherit them for life, for good, bad, indifferent, sending them to resources. And I am not your traditional police officer. I don't view everything as criminal and non-criminal. I view everything as the ability to make society better. And that was my goal when I came here. And Marty and I discussed it. We batted it back and forth. She wasn't really keen on the idea. And I said, listen, just try the program. I said, my offer remains there. I have agreed with all 5 schools, crystal clear, we do not criminally charge anybody without concurrence from the school. Full day Friday. That's all.
So can I just add that's all right. So if that, what you just said, that's great. So do you have any objection to put, why isn't that in the memorandum of understanding?
We certainly can. Marty and I explored, I think, about 7 different MOUs, and we literally took bits and pieces of each one, but her motto was the same as mine. The KISS principle, keep it simple, and she'd like the cut down version. There was agencies out there that had 15-page MOUs, and they spelled incidents out specifically, and I went, no, this is Frontier. We gotta keep this basic. We have an agreement. I've been chief now for approaching 5 years. I've held to my agreement since day one. We have not varied. So my goal was to improve all of our relationships, and so once we decided to push the program forward, then by the federal guidelines, we went into a selection phase. And what I did is I notified everybody on my agency that we're going to be posting for school resource officer. Once people put in for it, Marty Barrett, Darius, and Scott, and I sat down and said, who is going to be the best fit for our children? And everybody agreed the best fit was a born and raised kid in town named Brian Radish. His stepson graduated here 3 years ago. His daughter Hannah is in school here now. Brian loves kids as much as I do. My wife did say I can have 3 more kids. I just need to find a new wife, that's all. So we've seen the program already take off. We've seen our rapport increase with the students. We just sent Brian and Jen Bartek to what's called RAD Instructor School. And it's a self-defense school. And it was huge in Sturbridge. It was huge when somebody's husband used to teach it here every year. And we'd like to offer it to the community. We'd like to offer it to the student body. We just purchased impaired driving goggles. The goggles that we actually can take to junior and senior classes before prom, we can put them on them, we put cones up, and we literally have little carts that they have to try and navigate through the cones at different levels of impairment. So they can actually sit there and laugh at each other and go, oh my God, it's that bad. And we want that. We want that relationship. We want to prevent a fatal accident. We want to prevent injuries. And so I think the program's great. When I spearheaded it, Deerfield Academy offered to give me $30,000 a year towards it. And I kind of figured the 180-day school year, and Marty and I went through the whole thing, and she and I basically came up with a figure that we thought was okay and reasonable. And I think it's very reasonable. I think it's $15,000-some-odd from the regional school district. So not only does Brian deal with Frontier, but when there's problems in the other schools, it's nice to have that common face with the principals. It's nice to have the commonality with the superintendent and the principal at Frontier with one person dealing with a situation that can de-escalate parents. Because the last thing we want to do is criminally charge a parent and inflate a situation. So far I think the program's been extremely successful. We're involved, or I'm not involved, but Brian's involved in teaching numerous classes. And he certainly can discuss those with you, but I know the kids certainly enjoy it. But I'll certainly field any questions.
Anybody have any questions?
Just, when I saw your memorandum of understanding, that was the month, that April of last year, that was the month that Mr. Dredge and Mr. Modesto were in here, and because that was the month that our cameras, the new installation, they were to thank us for the new installation of cameras that caught the petty thief. And they remarked how they wanted us to know that we were at essentially crime-free school, that incidents were deserving of a police response were at an all-time record low. And I asked them specifically, would a police officer on staff make the school safer? And the response was, you can't get any safer than what we're already at. Then 2 weeks later, I saw in the newspaper that, from town meeting in Deerfield, that it was going to be your intention to put a police officer on our staff. And I just wonder how that disconnect got from being safest ever to now we need a police officer on our staff.
Mm-hmm. And I can't answer that because obviously I can't speak on their behalf. Is crime low here? Yes, it is. Do we enjoy that? Very much so, but that doesn't mean that we don't take and try and formulate a better society for the future. Bless you. So if we interact with those kids and we have a great rapport with them and they're not afraid as adults or children to reach out to the police department for lifelong assistance, that's a positive thing. 15 grand out of 10 million for that possibility, this is not about crime. This is not about, we get fights in the school and they're referred over for administrative action. We don't deal with them criminally. The parents call us after the fact and the parents want to file criminal charges, but we actually mitigate the situation so these kids don't end up with criminal records, because we all here are for the same cause. They're kids. They're supposed to make mistakes. So this is not about crime. This is about creating an open and honest relationship with society in the future. That's what it's about for me.
Well, I get that. The law that permits or requires school resource officers in schools with a waiver process for schools that don't want one. I'm sorry. I lost my train of thought. When I looked at our budget and I saw that we can't afford a school psychologist who is a person of tremendous resources to our students, mm-hmm. and we are instead contemplating hiring a school resource, someone without as much resources for our students as the school psychologist that we are, I mean, you agree with that, right? The school psychologist is going to have more resources to our students than what you can represent. And I don't get how we can't afford a psychologist who has actual resources for the kids, but we can afford to hire a self-described resource officer instead. And
don't look at me, I'm biased.
Like I get that. And that it's one thing to say, all right, school resource, it's a whole nother thing to ask the town of Conway to make direct payments to the Deerfield Police through the school, to make payments to the Deer, 250 years. We've never been asked to make a payment to the Deerfield Police Department for services that you've been providing all along.
Mm-hmm. Don't think of it as Conway is paying Deerfield. Think of it as we are all a family of Frontier. There is not a Waverly group here. There is not...
But we police our towns differently.
We are Frontier. And this is our whole family.
And what a concerned parent in my town was talked to me about was that there's a perception that your town enforces its laws differently than my town, and that it's particularly there's a perception that Deerfield enforces its motor vehicle laws at least with a more of a gotcha attitude than what my town does, and that if you've been living in my town long enough. Pretty much everybody has gotten the ticket for making a California stop at 10 o'clock at night when there's no other car in the road, but there's a Deerfield police officer, and it's like a hidden tax. If you're from Conway, once every 5-10 years, you got to pay for because it's a gotcha kind of a thing, and that's just not the experience of people with their law enforcement in our town. And so the concern was, is that the attitude that you're going to be bringing to their children, since that's already the attitude that they experience from you themselves?
Yeah, see, I can't even back that up, because last time I looked at our motor vehicle statistics, 94% of traffic stops resulted in a verbal warning or written warning. 6% resulted in a citation. 6%. If you look at the traffic flow in Deerfield and the accident ratio...
How was my wife quite two of those 6% in 5 years?
I'm here on a personal agenda.
Tell her to slow down like I tell my wife.
I'm here on a personal agenda. We need to move on. Anybody else got anything else? Judy?
I'm coming at it from two sides. So my daughter has given me feedback on the school resource office. And you have a pug, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, my God.
Dog's very...
Well, there you go.
Yeah. So nice gateway into the community. You know, my personal experience from her perspective is that she doesn't feel sort of threatened or uncomfortable about the school resource officer being in the school. But the flip side, and I do agree with you, is that the diminishment of mental health services in the school as the population of students incrementally increases, even if it's like a little fraction of an amount, is a little disheartening to me. The school psychologist cut of 0.6, I don't know if that's due to a retirement or whatever, but So that part does worry me, and I'm willing to accept that there's a balance and that they both might have a place in the school, but I don't want to see us lose one and gain the other. And accept the responsibility, like the ongoing responsibility of the resource officer being in the school, the financial and fiscal responsibility of it, without also considering mental health at the same time as you're assessing well-being and community policing in the school.
See, like I would have been much more comfortable if you guys would have agreed to put this on a separate warrant and to come to all four towns and do this little spiel. And that's building community support for what you're doing from now that you're asking for our money from each of our towns. That it's like a moral obligation for you guys to come to the town to ask for the support from at town meeting from the towns and to introduce yourselves to the parents and explain why you're here, what the program's about, and more importantly, explain that you being here is not a statement on this. We're trying to recruit kids every year. Kids have a choice about where parents can the insinuation that now that we're at record low crime, now all of a sudden we're needing to hire on our payroll a school resource officer could really be dealt with fairly were you guys to agree to come to the four towns. You probably don't need to go to Deerfield, the three other towns, and introduce yourself. You're the new school resource officer, and ask for the town's support. And that way, would you be willing to agree to that?
I have to interrupt you. That's not really your asking them to do that. That has to be the committee asking them to do that.
Well,
so if you're making that suggestion.
No, I'm asking if they'd be willing to do that before.
Of course, they'd be willing to come.
Absolutely.
They have very good relationships.
Well, put it this way, Phil.
Put it this way.
If the town of Waitley doesn't want, in some years, don't want us to come and talk about million-dollar budgets, why would you think they would want them that's doing a duty for us, helping us, deterring things that's going on here? If you remember when you and I went to school, what went on in our school, we didn't have, unless you went to a big school, we didn't have a police officer there, and a lot of crap went on.
We had a police officer who was insane and tormented me to no end.
But you must have been bad to him. Maybe, Phil. That's it. But let me tell you
something.
Okay,
wait a minute. We're changing directions. That's fine.
I just had some questions about the numbers. So the $52,000 position, 30 coming from DA, and then 15 coming from here. Is the Deerfield Police Department picking up the remaining 8?
Yes. In the MOU, it actually states that the town is picking up all benefit costs and any other associated costs.
And then you said 5 schools?
5 schools.
And so, do you think is the amount of time the school resource officer spends in each school the same, or is there?
No, in general, what you'll see from Brian is he's in Frontier 20 to 25 hours a week. He's at Deerfield Academy for presence 10 to 15 hours a week, and then he pops into the elementary school in Bement and Eagle Brook really as needed. Okay. So his primary focus, correct me if I'm wrong, 75% of the time, is Frontier Regional, and Keith Fine and the CFO up at Deerfield Academy is perfectly fine with that. He sees the larger picture, and as long as we're up there 10 or 15 hours a week, he loves the visibility, and the kids up there like the program as well. So,
anybody else?
Just as an aside to this whole thing, Budget Subcommittee, we talked about this a little bit, Patty has a plan in place where this becomes a sort of budget neutral, and I'll tell you where it comes from if you want to know. If you look on page 14 of 32 in your budget.
What page?
14. If you see under FY18 proposed, you follow it down to where it says $69,416. That money was put there because if you look to the left of it, last year tuition to Commonwealth and charter schools, we had to put $69,788 in there because we were upside down. Mm-hmm. We're not going to be upside down. That 69,416 is not committed at this point. So if you had to go looking for 15, that's where you'd go. If you were looking for 15 to fund this, you can go to that line item and take the 15 from the 69, and you'll still have 54 of that going back into the school choice account. But the money is there, and the whole thing is budget neutral. Doesn't cost. I won't say it doesn't cost you. Of course, it costs you $15,000. But it's not like you had to take our 3% budget and add $15,000 to it, because you don't. It's already been found by accident.
Is the $30,000 annual Deerfield DA contribution, is that permanent?
It's permanent so long as Keith is the CFO at Deerfield Academy. he does not feel it's appropriate in his position to lock the school in permanently forever in a replacement for himself in the future. But as long as he's there, he has told me, we will get the money every single year.
So is there a reason that you never asked Eaglebrook or Bement?
I asked Eaglebrook and Bement. The problem is Bement is really budget neutral. There's not a lot of money up there. Their endowment's low. So they gave us $1,000 towards the position, and Eaglebrook values the position. We just haven't got a donation from them yet. So my hope is as people see the benefit of this program and the resources that we can bring, that they actually will increase over the years their acceptance. And I understand that takes time, especially when it comes to a cop.
Until then, we're subsidizing Eaglebrook's police protection?
Like I said, they go up there as needed. You're talking Frontiers 20, 25 hours a week.
Is the RAD class going to be during the day, or is that something that's going to be offered as an after school?
It's going to be offered to the girls during the gym class.
During the physics class?
Yep, during the physics class. I just haven't set the details up with Ms. Marhar yet.
Are you targeting seniors?
It would be open for any.
So any age group is fine. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Obviously, as time goes on, we're going to refine the program.
Sure, sure.
Yeah.
I just have a question about the program itself.
Sure.
So, not the money. So the idea is that you will go to the elementary schools and spend time here and build a rapport with students as they're coming up through the ranks.
Yes.
So that when they graduate from high school and they're out and about, or even when they're still in high school and they're out and about, you have this relationship with the student. And I totally get that, and I think that would be really, really good. I do wonder, however, that a relationship that a student has with you, if they get into a fight in the middle of the street in South Deerfield and you come upon them, you're going to be able to break up that fight, right? Because you've got that rapport. If there's a fight in the street and it's another police officer, are they going, they're not going to be as effective as you? I mean, I totally get it if you are there for every situation where somebody is having a problem, but you're not going to be there in every situation. So is the rapport that you build with the community going to trickle down to other police officers?
I think so, but I think the situation as a whole is a little different. Monday morning when I walk in the door, first thing I do and Brian does is we go through the entire weekend log. We pull the arrest folders. If we see there's a juvenile in there that's charged, first thing that he and I are looking at is this a repeat offender? Is the school okay with this? Where are they at? Is our psychologist involved? Do we need to look at a deferral program so this is not on the kid's record for life? And we start going through all these different resources of what we can do. And there are times where it literally hits the level and the school's like, we need him charged or her. It's hit that level where nobody else has been able to intervene. We actually need the court to interject here. And that's okay. But on the other side, if there's a fight in the street and they value a relationship with police officers and they respect police officers because in their upbringing they have a positive role model and not harassed, they are more likely to respond. As soon as a Mark Cruiser pulls up, they're going to back away. And that's the relationship we want. We don't want to just go lock people up. I don't care about my arrest statistics. I don't care about them at all. So I think overall it's going to impact everybody in a positive light. And, you know, the school psychologist, I can't fight that. I think that's a critical position that I can't even talk about. But what I can tell you is from our agency and the resources that we bring to the table, whether it's the No Fires program or diversion programs, it's great and it's good for the student body.
I just wanted to say thank you for making that distinction between the school psychologist and the school resource officer. I do agree that, you know, anytime we diminish the role of mental health, it's not a great thing to do. Though, and I would like to hear from Darius on kind of where that's going, but I would like the two to be distinguished. The other thing I just want to say is thank you for what you do, because whether the child is from Sunderland, Waitley, Conway, or Deerfield, I would hope that child would respond similarly to a police officer in those towns because they've had a role model in their school. Because we are a community school, we happen to encompass four communities, but we're a community school.
And I work with the school counselor and a psychologist on a daily basis with problems in the school.
We do home visits.
We do home visits.
At their request.
At their request.
But only in Deerfield, not in the other towns.
We will if we notify the surrounding chief with their permission. We don't step on anybody's toes.
We don't step on anybody's toes.
Yeah.
We will go with.
Yeah, but we've actually stuck Scott or Darius in our cruiser before, unmarked cruiser, and gone right to a house and literally just intervened and got the child assistance. And that's our job. Putting handcuffs on people, that's 1950s. It's done. We're in a new age. We're in an education age where we really want to help people.
And I feel a lot better listening to a lot of what you said. And
I've actually helped students in Frontier from Conway that has been stopped
I get that, but
from for speeding by the Conway police. So just to throw that out there, it's not just here.
You realize that Chief in Conway's going to hear about that.
I'm sorry.
Excuse me a minute. You're lucky you didn't text.
And a lot of my concerns really are just the MUA just kind of leads you in different directions. When you consider that it's your job to keep the school drug free, and so that brings up the question of marijuana. And do you get involved? Do you know when a kid is caught with marijuana in school, even though that's not a crime?
So well, it is if you're under 18.
Under 18,
yeah. Just like alcohol.
Most of them are under 18.
But that's
and
not.
Cigarettes.
Right, it's under the same kind of thing as cigarettes or alcohol, correct?
But if you're
in
under
school.
The age of 21, it's totally different. It's like alcohol.
So until you got here for the first...
That's not my concern. If somebody's caught here with marijuana, they're not going out with handcuffs.
We don't enter.
I get that, but for the first 7 years of marijuana prohibition did not involve automatic referral to the attention of the on-staff police officer. In the 1 year since it's been legalized in this state, you now participate.
Participate at all? That's Mr. Dredge's deal.
You know where it becomes effective, Phil, is when we deal with a kid on the side of the road, or with their family, or a parent calls us on the weekends, and we have a tracking history on that kid so we can get them help. And whether they smoke pot to self-medicate or whatever their means is for using it, it allows us to facilitate between all parties, the parents, the school counselor, the principal. This is not about us getting called in Mr. Dredge's office and saying, oh, by the way, we're going to summon you. What's your social security number? That's gone. That's long gone. We don't charge people. I've charged two people at Frontier Regional in 4.5 years. One threat to reenact Columbine, which I take pretty personal, and the other burned your school. He lit the bathroom on fire. Two people. That's it. There are no other criminal charges out here. And under the Freedom of Information Act, you can look at our records. That's it. I'm a man of my word.
John, going forward, assuming we can find the money to fund this year.
Yes, Bob.
Going forward, are you going to have an additional source of revenue once the pot building gets built on 5 and 10 across from Yankee Candle?
That was actually as part of our MOU with the medical marijuana folks is they wanted to fund a school resource officer, and they actually talked about funding a school psychologist at one point. So what we did is we agreed that they would give us 3% of their gross revenues into a public safety account. So if you go through Deerfield annual town meeting, you will notice a public safety account in revolving under 53E1/2 in the amount of $250 or $250,000. There's no money in there yet because they haven't opened the facility and they have not started
but going
selling.
Forward, you would assume that you'd have a sufficient revenue to be able to carry it.
My goal is to carry the position completely out of there and alleviate it off the backbone here. Deerfield Academy, different story.
Well, yes. We keep taking their
yes.
money. To but,
yeah.
But the point is, you need us to come up with the money for this year, and you would anticipate that facility being open and we getting revenue, so you won't need to come back to us next year.
The problem, Bob, is I can't guarantee next year. I don't know where they're at. It depends on the planning board, the ZBA. It depends on when they open.
I'm not saying we want to guarantee. I want to guarantee. I just want to say that if everything goes well, you won't need to come back for the other 15.
That is true. Yes, that is true.
So,
yes.
So aside from all the drugs and the alcohol and all that type of stuff, the really great things you do, could you speak a little bit more about RAD? I'm also a RAD instructor. And I think it's really cool that Deerfield's getting involved in this, and we have a four-town kind of team going now.
Yep.
And so if you could speak about that for the girls, you're going to love this, moms.
Yeah, I'm actually really excited about teaching this. I have taught football here at Frontier for 4 years. I was a football coach. I teach at the police academies. So teaching is kind of my thing. And when I went to this instructor school, I didn't really know anything about RAD or what it was for. And going through the school, once I graduated, going through the 30 hours block of instruction in 3 days, I was like, wow, every woman in America should take this program and learn that they can defend themselves against an aggressor, an attacker, somebody who's going to do them harm, that they have the ability to defend themselves against an attack. No woman should ever be attacked, sexually assaulted, in any way, shape, or form. It shouldn't happen, unfortunately. It does. Mm-hmm. And this program that I will give to the students, I'll teach the students and the faculty and the staff. I'm going to offer it to them also. Dr. Carey can even take the class if she wishes. I think it's probably the most rewarding thing for me to teach anybody, no matter what age, what size they are, what I'm just so ecstatic about it. I can't wait. My equipment just came in. I haven't gone through it all yet. I'm gonna offer it also to people from Deerfield, Conway, Waitley, Sunderland, Greenfield, Turners, anybody, anywhere. Summertime, or if I'm having classes, I'm going to offer it also to anybody who's not a student. I'm going to also bring the program up to Deerfield Academy. I've approached Deerfield Academy for their faculty, staff, and their student population, female student population. So this could be a full-time job for me, this RAD thing. I'm really excited about it. I have asked two teachers, because what I'd like to do is host a RAD instructor school here in the town of Deerfield. And I've asked two teachers that teach here at Frontier if they'd be willing to become instructors and help me teach. And they said absolutely yes. They'd be more than willing to help and to go through the class, become an instructor, and help me teach.
Keeping in mind that these are female instructors, because the only people that qualify for RAD instructors are police officers and females who have been courted.
And females, yes.
Mm-hmm. So I mean, it's a real pretty safe environment.
Yeah.
Oh, is there a component for males?
There is.
Yeah.
There's a component for males. That would be another class that I would have to go.
No, I figured I'm on their website.
There is a component for males. That's something that I'm not certified to teach yet.
Okay.
When I went through the RAD instructor for female, there was a police officer from another agency who had been a RAD instructor for male. It's nothing that I'm really interested in doing right now. I believe me, what I had to physically endure in this class, being also a sexual assault investigator, I can't ever say to anybody that I would know what it feels like to be sexually assaulted, because I don't. but I could tell, I could empathize with a female who's been sexually assaulted, how she felt powerless. Okay, because they took the fight away from me when I went through the instructor school, and you could testify because you've seen this. I repressed some of the things that happened in my scenario. So also being a sexual assault investigator, if I ask a female who's been sexually assaulted, do you remember what he looked like? Do you remember what he said to you? And she says no. Now I have empathy towards her. I can understand what she had repressed these things that happened to her. So it was an unbelievable experience. It was unbelievable. I'm excited about it. I can't wait to start the program up.
So these are going to be done mainly, this is going to be done mainly through PE classes?
Yes.
These are going to be targeting a specific grade level. I'm wondering how, are you going to get through an entire senior class? Are you going to get through every kid? And then within the limited, I mean, the 20, 25 hours or so that...
Until I have extra instructors, I have a small student to instructor ratio. So right now it's like an 8-to-1, so I have 8 students to 1 instructor. I can call on also other instructors who are certified to come down and help me teach. I have 2 in another agency real close. I have a lot of equipment also that can come down. So I can call on extra instructors to come in. It's another family network.
I'm just wondering what is the totality of the kids that are going to be able to experience it.
Right. I'm going to try to get every kid that wants to experience it.
He's on a rat high right now.
Through. I'm on what they call a rat high.
Yeah. And actually, that's what you really do want, because it's so empowering for females.
Is it going to be a specific profile or group that you're going to start with? Or I'm just wondering how...
That's
how many are you going to be able to reach?
Yeah, that's something I'm going to, I'm working details out right now with Ms. Marhart, who we're going to get to come first, whether it be seniors, juniors. It'll probably be the seniors first, because they're the ones first out the door, and they're going to be going off to college and adult life and stuff like that, put in situations where, you know, something might or could happen to them. Time is kind of the essence. It was offered to me. I took the class. Now I'm working against the clock. So I was waiting for my certification finally to come in. I had to order my equipment. That finally came in. So now I'm like ready to start. So like, I can start tomorrow. you know, it's great. So I will be talking again with Ms. Marhart tomorrow. Okay, when are we going to do this? This is the time. This is what I want. So yeah, time is of the essence of this year. And of course, obviously, we got to figure it out. We got to, how are we going to do this? How are we going to fit it into PE? So
I think just that point of it warrants us having a conversation to try this for a year. Bob, you got something?
I'd like to have the board vote to direct the budget subcommittee to create a line in next year's budget for the $15,000, with the understanding that hopefully the this won't have to happen next year because they should have sufficient funding to take care of it.
Is that a motion?
Yes.
Do I have a second?
I'd like to second that, please.
Any other discussion? Hearing none? All those in favor? Opposed? Abstaining? Okay. Good to go. Thank you so much for coming in.
Any last minute questions?
Yeah.
Don't ask.
Just one other question. Just one other question. The one thing that I really didn't get to hear you guys talk about is just in the unfortunate, we have a use of force policy in our school for employees that says it's always minimum force necessary.
Mm-hmm.
Is that, I mean, that's not necessarily what the law would normally grant you more leeway than that.
But policy is one and the same. We have an escalating policy where we always start with minimal. We want to talk our way out of anything. The 10 to 20 year old days are long gone. Every kid has a camera on them. And the second a school resource officer oversteps their bounds or puts their hands on a kid, don't think for one second there's not 5 students in that class recording it. And it is going to make Deerfield PD on CNN. So those days are gone.
So like I always thought it would take, I don't actually think that I could, because if someone punches me in the face, I don't know if I can not punch them back, but that's really what's requested of you.
That.
Okay.
Okay, moving along. Bob?
I just had one question. Does your resource officer have a body camera?
No. No body cameras. I haven't bought into the body cameras yet for a vast variety of reasons. The technology is still not where we need it to be. The batteries are not lasting an entire shift. There's redaction issues, there's court compliance issues, there's privacy issues. Legislature needs to jump on board, and there's many things in the laws they need to fix, and we're more than happy to carry cameras. I don't care about cameras. What I care about is violating people's rights, and I refuse to do that. So it gets into a whole different area with courts and discovery requests and editing out certain parts of it. Who has authority to edit it out? This is way beyond, we just want to monitor the cops to make sure they're doing the right thing.
But the thing is, the cops have got one step against them because the kids are going to record everything possible they can to stick it to them.
Oh, absolutely.
And,
yeah.
You know, you have nothing there to protect your own interests.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I bring it up.
Yeah.
Again, thank you for coming
in. Thanks, guys.
Okay.
Thanks,
Mark. Thank you.
Bob,
thank
you. We're trying to find to put a line in this year's 2018.
Yep, that's what he made the motion for.
Oh, God, you're following me.
That's what we...
Yeah, this...
That's what we voted for, was
but
for the 18.
The understanding is...
For the budget subcommittee to look
into. To look into
The understanding is that next year, they shouldn't need any money because that facility gets relocated in Deerfield on the Whately Town line. It should have sufficient revenues to take care of.
And we can revisit it yearly to make sure.
What's that?
3% is a lot of money.
They're figuring, he's talking about $250,000 in receipts.
How much?
He mentioned setting up the revolving account with $250,000.
Well, I think we can revisit it again, but we need to move along now. I think they did a great job, and I'm really glad that we had them come in, and thank you, Lynn, for getting in touch with them. So I think we have to backtrack now, so I think we're at call to order. No, kidding. Public comment? The public is up, sir. Report, Student Advisory Council is not here tonight, so if they do pop in, we'll see them.
No excuse.
Unfinished business, long-range facilities plan.
Hello.
So you have stuff for us, further discussion?
Are you ready for the discussion on the roof?
Yep. We're at long range facilities and we can mush it all together.
We do not want to go with this $5,000 for the net.
Yeah, basically the $5,500 to Beacon Integrated Solutions. I talked with the consultant that we were using to look at these net metering things, and she said the market has swung in a direction again where she is afraid that she'd come out here and look at something that wouldn't bear anything to the town.
So
she made a commitment to me that she's going to watch the market very carefully, and if it gets to a point where there's something out there and something that we should be interested in, she's going to come to us. So she felt at this point it wouldn't be a great venture for us. So I appreciate that. It was a good gesture on her part. Our eyes open and give that market in the direction that we should be paying attention to it again. And she's going to give us a call.
Good. Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
I'm hoping here that we can get plugged in and.
Sorry about that.
All right. Stick this in the USB drive on here. I'm hoping, what I tried to do, I've been up on the roof a bunch of times in the last couple of weeks before the heavy snows came. And I took as many pictures as I could, and I think it's going to give you a really good idea of the order of magnitude of what's up there with the roof. And
we just didn't have
That's okay. No, no worries.
Get started. I'm sorry.
Don't trip over that one.
Where are the lights? Are they behind you, Andy?
There we go.
So we're going to be a little bit in the dark.
So we're going to an island?
It's going to cost a little.
Don't go too much further.
No, you're done.
That's what the cafeteria looked like before the new roof went on.
So let me... Oh, there we go. It's no name. Thank you. And this would be the group?
This is for old school committee members, retired chair.
We're gonna build a tree out of those two trees up on the island up there.
It's where the chief puts school committee members and asks too many questions.
Actually, Bob, that's gonna be a new charter school.
I'm just wondering why it's not.
Betsy's gonna approve it.
If you want to, we can unplug your computer and probably plug it right directly into it. I had it put in that way earlier today.
I think you had to go into the settings.
Yeah.
The display setting?
Yeah, you gotta mirror it through the display settings.
Maybe just don't swear about this point yet.
Well, let's see if we can do this, because these pictures are pretty important.
Can we have the light again for a second?
Because I think we're.
Oh, we need warning on that one?
I'll get out of the shot.
One at a time, man. One at a time.
The line item, that's basically for the research out of it, basically just stick it in. But that's not.
So your question I have that you want to ask me now is when you get to the system. Why is there making it in?
There should be some reason here.
Yeah, USB.
That's an add-on wall.
So that is.
Yeah.
Yeah, it should be it.
You still have the white food services, it's never.
Because they never want you to be known.
There, I'm gonna, you turn the light out and I'll use my phone here to light what I'm doing and hopefully we'll get this to work.
Great, thank you.
Reduce the assessments on what they're showing to below double digits for us. So we'll get that to you.
We're not alone.
USB is what we want.
Yeah.
Why am I not getting up to USB?
Yeah.
You have to click on the folders, no? Of course, you're asking me.
I'm not sure why it's not working for us yet.
Well, why don't you just give us a.
Can we have Andy look at it? That'd be okay? Because Andy's pretty good at this stuff. Do you want to change it on that? To USB or do you want to go through the computer? Oh, good.
You can do it?
Yes, I'm sure you can. Are you familiar with MacBooks?
Yeah.
Andy, I sense a new headline. Ace reporter saves the day.
And it's not a distortion.
It's exactly, exactly. Ace reporter keeps meeting from grinding to a crushing standstill.
Ace reporter needs a quiet.
Well, meanwhile, for your reading pleasure, I am handing out the information that Bob is going to be showing us. And, oh, do you need my password to get in there, Andy?
No. Just say it out loud, everybody.
You don't tell anybody.
Well, the displays are mirrored. Oh, you know why? It's because.
Thank you.
You have to change this.
When we talk about children's neurodiversity, being different today than they were a generation ago because of the, it's actually the millennial neurodiversity. Is it all set?
Yep.
So, wait a minute, maybe I'm not. This is 72, and this is 80.
So now what do we do?
Yeah, I'm not sure what you've done for us here.
You see what I'm saying?
Can you get back to the files that you were?
Can you open up his?
Yeah, I don't know where the file is.
It's
you had plugged
right
it into
there.
The projector, I think.
Yeah, so it's right there.
Is that a visual?
It's right there.
I just want to go up and.
Click on no name.
Okay.
Okay, and there's the roof.
Okay.
click on this one or work.
The chair is going to call a recess while we get this all straightened up. So are you on pause?
All right. I think we have.
Are you back? All right, the chair is not calling a recess.
All right. Yeah. Basically, what we're talking about in the roof is this entire metal structure here. You know, you've got all of this and the siding here and the clear story with the window in it. That's all a metal roof that was put in around 1980 when they did a renovation of an older roof over the library media center.
But you're talking, you're not only talking the roof, you're talking about the siding too.
The siding,
yes.
Yeah.
The metal siding's also.
That large vertical space in the back, the siding that you see here on this angle, and the roof section. All of that metal is different. If you come this way in the school, you see another metal. That was a standing seam metal roof put in during the latest renovation. That all of that's in really good shape. But this particular section of roof is about 12,000 square feet of material. And when we get on some of the other pictures, you'll see it a little closer. There's a deterioration of the finish, which some people that I brought up and looked at that saw it as a big issue, and other people that I brought up there recently said maybe that's not such a big issue. So, but there are some things with flashing and stuff that as we go through here, I will show you what they do. I'm already getting it. What's going to switch from picture to picture?
I'm going to do it.
All right.
So that you can
get it. I'll let you do it. That's good. And I'll talk about it. How's that?
Okay, that sounds good.
Oop. They should go automatically. All right. This gives you, this picture here gives you a good idea. You can see the metal in the front where the finish is coming off it. And you can also see the clear story windows. Unfortunately, that line of the top of the bulletin board is right at the top of the glass. If that wasn't there, what you'd see is you can see some. Yeah, great, that's good. If you look closely, you can actually see some of the gaskets in those windows that are hanging down. And that's one of the firm prices I have now is a price for resetting the glass. There's two different options on that we can talk about.
Correct me if I'm wrong, basically what we're talking about here, we keep calling it roof, but a lot of it is vertical.
Yes.
That standing seam metal roof to the left or the right of that protrusion in the top, there's nothing wrong with that.
That's right. That's correct.
Okay, I just want to make sure everybody understands. You're talking about the surfaces that are up and down. We could talk about roofs, everybody thinks of the flat part. The flat part up there, it's not flat, it's not an incline, but to the left or the right of the glass windows is not the problem.
The reason I tend to call this a roof is because you'll see later with some of the pictures is other than the space in the library that leads up to that clear story, that's a big cavernous empty space.
Yep.
There's not a lot in there.
Is that something we can do without?
That's where you're.
That's where your daylight comes in.
HVAC.
Is that where it is? Okay.
Now that this is a good example of what we're talking about. I'm calling this. You're right, we're calling this all a roof, but it's this metal structure. And the couple of guys standing here give you some perspective of the size and the magnitude of that. And you can get a good look there. You know, it's about 30 feet high there. And it's also on a PVC roof. So when we start talking about working up there, we're going to have some issues with scaffolding. And we're going to want to have somebody working up there that is going to be very aware of the roof they're working on and not do any damage to it.
Are they standing on the standing seam metal roof, or are they on the rubber membrane where they're standing right now?
Where they're standing on a PVC roof. Most of the flats in the building are a white PVC roof, which is in pretty good shape. We do some patching here and there in little spots, but it's in pretty good shape. The roof that's there is a standing seam roof, but it's a single lock. It's not a double standing seam roof. It's a metal roof, and it's galvanized, and the staining that you see there, or the, not really staining, it, the discoloration that appears there is the fact that the finish is washing off that roof. But the metal is in very good condition. And one of the, and if you look, you'll see it in some of the subsequent slides, you'll see very closely that for some reason the panels on some exposures are in really good shape, and some of them are in really bad shape. The slope section on top generally is pretty good. The east and west exposures are generally pretty good. The north and the very small vertical section on the south shows a lot of this type of staining. Can we go to another?
Can we just say something there, Bob? Because you showed me these already when we came to your office and we looked at these a little bit. Some of the things I found out with metal roofing over the years by selling it, and if you look at different properties that have metal roofing, this could have just been a, this back, which is facing north, that doesn't get any sun at all. It might have been a run of batch of metal roofing, which is the siding here, that could have just been a batch that had a bad paint job. And in this, over time, it just deteriorated. It's not from the sun, because if it was facing south, you'd say, oh, it's the sun that did it. But it's facing north. Other than northwest winds blowing against it in the wintertime, that's the only thing, harsh things that go against this thing. So I contributed to a bad batch that went through, meaning just a paint job, for what I know.
Interestingly, I had a painter look at this, or excuse me, a roofer look at this, and he strongly suggested we refinish it. And then I had an architect, and it's expensive. I mean, buying a really high quality finish and doing the surface preparation that's necessary to really do a good job of refinishing this whole section of roof is gonna be a $50,000 or $60,000 project. When I brought a envelope roofing consultant up to look at this, he said, you know, the roofing is still in pretty good shape. The biggest reason at this point you may want to refinish that roof is just cosmetics. If people are gonna start complaining how it looks, you may wanna do that. But he said, you know, you may wanna think about not doing it, because if we do paint that and we don't get the surface preparation perfect, we could have problems with it peeling. We can just skip over that. That's just another shot of that whole area.
But Bob,
can we go back to that just for a second? One of the things that, again, inside of that entire wall is, and we'll see it in a slide pretty quickly, is an empty cavernous space. Access to that space for service to the equipment that's up there is very difficult through a hatch in the library media center. One of the things that's been recommended to me that I think is a great idea is we ought to cut an access door from the roof into that space. It wouldn't be very expensive at all, and it would make it much more convenient and much safer to do service work in that space. That's the space. I mean, there's someone standing in there. There's a very small catwalk on the north side, and then most of the rest of that space is just ductwork over a suspended acoustical ceiling. And the walks in there are small. There's a concrete block around the elevator, and there's a concrete block around the air handling unit. There's a fair amount of traffic up there for service to the air handling equipment, and it's a very dicey place to be. As you can see, all the metal on the inside looks pretty good. And the insulation is at the ceiling of the Library Media Center. So that entire space up there is very cold in the winter, and also has some issues with the metal roof. It gets very hot in the summer. So, you know, one of the things that, as we get to some of the things I'm proposing to do, is if we re-insulate that deck in a better way than it's insulated now, there are going to be some significant energy savings.
Bob, question. With the water stains that are on the ceiling below that,
mm-hmm.
do you think any of them came from the handling system or the air conditioning system,
no,
or could it drip down through?
No, I don't. I've got pretty good ideas, and I'll show you as we're okay. talking where we've had all of our leaks. One of the places that we have
a chair. There's a chair right here.
One of the places we've had a lot of leaks is there's a PVC joint. There's a PVC to metal flashing all around the perimeter of this structure. It goes this way and that way. A lot of our leaks are at that PVC joint there. And as we go up higher, I'll show you some of the other places. And, you know, redoing that entire PVC joint is not a horribly expensive project. And it's something that I would strongly recommend we consider doing. Go one more. You can just skip over them. I'm just, there's a couple of them in there that are just...
Bob, I saw there was a drain up there, and I think I asked you last time about the drain.
Yeah.
You said they do get clogged?
We send our custodians, there are roof drains on yep. PVC flats up there, and our custodians go up at least once, sometimes twice a year, and clean all of them.
Do you think if it's ever been clogged before, that there have been so much water up there, could have got into one of those seams or get over the seam
well,
on something?
I'll show you some okay. pictures. With the last snowstorm we had,
yeah.
There was a lot of heavy blowing, wet snow, and we had a spike in leaks. And what it was from was water with the snow packing into that seam. And
okay.
Normally those drains are open and it doesn't pond on the with a lot of snow and stuff, we have a lot of issues. Go ahead, just. That's just another, it gives you an idea of that. It's unusual, again, that the wall on the back is the north side and this is the south side, and yet the east and west sides seem to be pretty good.
Those glass windows and those rubber gaskets around the windows are suspects in this operation, too, aren't they?
Yes, those I would just very, very strongly recommend. You know, we've got some reasonably good pricing from Greenfield Glass to reset those. And I would very, very strongly recommend that that's something we should do.
So Bob, I just want to say I appreciate that you're looking more at the sustainability side of things too, that the insulation is, because insulating the envelope, I mean, we know now building scientists told us you can buy the most expensive windows, but that's not going to be any efficient.
We're going to talk a lot about the insulation because if we don't paint that thing, the insulation costs are probably the biggest single cost that are going to remain in there. But I think they're really, really important. And you'll see in some of the subsequent pictures what's going on with that.
Okay.
That's just a quick thing I wanted to point out there. As you can see, you know, one of the problems we have is just sometimes blowing snow or negative air in there because the overlapping of that is... You see light there. I don't think that's a big part of the issue, but it's something as we do, we'll probably caulk all of those joints. That, again, is a picture of the interior of that, and what it really shows you, and you'll see some more as we go on, there's all of that insulation it's just on top of a suspended ceiling like this, and there's a lot of lights in there, and the insulation's been pulled away from the lights because of the heat that the lights generate. When I went up there a week or so ago with a consultant, he said you'd never be able to construct this like this now, because there's weight issues of the insulation on top of the acoustical ceiling. One of the things that was suggested to me was just blowing more insulation in there. I've got real problems with that. I don't think we should be adding weight to that. And I also have real issues about covering the existing lighting fixtures. I think, you know, one of the things that as we get on later, we're going to talk about maybe replacing those lighting fixtures and changing around where that insulation is. And as you look across that, you can see it's a very, very difficult place to work. As we go on a little bit, there's a couple things going on here. That white pipe up in the upper corner there is a roof drain that goes to a section of flat roof behind the clerestory. And that's one place there's a lot of our leaks. We didn't even know that was there until we kind of looked at that roof through Google Earth, and we noticed that right in the place we were having some problems, they must have, during the newest renovation, tried to fix the problem there by covering the metal with PVC. Can you go to the next one? That's the same picture, and you can start to see, you'll get another shot that's a little bit better, right where that marker is. That's the back side of that white PVC, and somebody's actually, I don't know how they ever got up there. I give them a lot of credit for doing it, because I wouldn't go up there. Somebody has put a big piece of plastic and a pail underneath that to catch some of the leak that's been going on there for years. Yeah, that's a better shot of it. You can see the pail hanging there. And actually what that is, there's a roof drain. That's a roof drain. I have no idea if it's plugged or not. There's no way I could get to that.
That's on the 30-foot wall.
Yeah.
Bob, who empties the pail?
Pardon me?
Who empties the pail?
Nobody. Hopefully it evaporates.
I hope it's a big
either pail. That or it's spilled over once. I have no idea. Anybody want to volunteer? That's just, you know, most of that, 99% of that metal on the inside, what I'm showing you is it's really good. There's a few places where there's a little surface corrosion starting, but it's not a big deal. That's air handling equipment that I'm assuming it was probably put in there in 1980. I talked just today with the people that do our HVAC service. They feel the cabinet and the outside equipment to that is in pretty good shape. I'd like to get rid of some of the old pneumatic actuators on that and hook it to our new energy management system and probably clean the coils and do some, you know, if we're going to be working up there and doing a bunch of stuff, spending a couple $1,000s to fix that unit and fix it right and make it a little more accessible makes a lot of sense to me, because it's just about impossible to get up there and work the way it is now. Let me skip over that one. Just another picture gives you an idea of the size of it. They're standing on the base of the elevator. That kind of gives you some perspective of what's going on with the insulation vats that are laid in there and the way that they're not at all the lighting fixtures. So there's big, huge, you know, it's just, there's no vapor barrier there. There's no air barrier there. There's just some insulation stack there.
Are those lights that are there from 1980?
Well, yeah, yes. Think? Yes, they are.
Okay.
Yeah. And part of, you know, there's a good opportunity if we can get some payback from the power company. If we replace those lights, we just did all of the lighting in Whately Elementary with LEDs. They love it there, and that would be a really good part of this project. Just go ahead and pop by that one. We're almost done here. Go ahead, one more. that's just, you know, the, I talked about the, as we go around, that's the PVC roofing, and that's the joint coming off the PVC roofing, going up into the metal roofing. And it's getting old and brittle. We can patch it pretty good. You'll see in the next picture, you know, only a couple of weeks ago, we did a patch in cold weather, and it, you know, it worked pretty good. But the bottom line is that joint is getting brittle, and it's going to keep breaking. And, you know, for the cost associated with replacing that whole joint, that's a really good part of this project.
Is that on the inside, Bob, or outside?
That's outside.
Okay.
That's a picture from, you know, we took a picture from Google Earth. It gives you some ideas. I penciled in the dimensions. You can see the clear story there. But at the top of the clear story, that white section appears to be PVC roofing that was put in to do a patch of a problem there. The fellow that I had up, the consultant that I had up looking at it, recommended really strongly that we pull that PVC out, and instead of having a flat section of roof there with a drain in it, we put a pitched piece of metal roof in. And that's just for perspective. Yeah. During the last snowstorm, we had the bucket brigade out in the library media center. That door, that's the librarian's office, and pretty much right above this area is the section that I was talking about, that's the back side of that clear story. And you can walk around the library, and 90% of the leaks that you're going to find are around the perimeter of that big structure or the back side of the clear story. We occasionally get some random leaks from wind-blown snow and stuff that come through those overlapping seams that I've showed you. But most of our leaks come in those couple of places.
Bob, did anybody by chance, did anybody go up there by chance, like today or when we've been having some warmer temperatures, just to see if they can see, you know, we know that seam, you took care of that corner there, but you know, if we got this many leaks, you should be able to see something to a point up there, if you went up above up there and walked around in that open area. But I'm not talking about on top of the roof, I'm talking about in that well, big room there.
You can only walk a so small area of it. And you can't get close to any of those things because yeah. It's so open.
Yeah.
One of the things, can we go, just if you go back just a couple of sheets to my discussion on, no, it's pretty close to the end. It's not one of the it's one of those front. That all right. So yeah, if we can just kind of walk. You know, I've got a bunch of notes, and if you bear with me, I'll kind of talk about some of this stuff. Looking at the roof there, it's a single or lock seam galvanized steel roof. It's not a standing seam roof. It's primarily a geometric architectural feature, and it's 12,000 square feet. It's a monstrosity that it is what it is. What you see on the surface is it's not a stain or rust. It's just the galvanized finish washing off. It's not a problem with the metal. It's purely an aesthetic thing. Recoating, you could do it or not do it. It could create some new problems. The primary leaks are at the glass in the clear story, the metal roof flashing at the bottom of that glass, the flashings where the metal roofs intersect at the clear story, and the PVC flat cricket at the top of the clear story, and the PVC flashing joint at the lower roof. And as we get down to some of the numbers, I've taken a shot at trying to predict what some of those things would cost. There are some other minor leaks that are related to wind direction, et cetera, during rain events. It's a big space. It's very hot in summer. It's cold in the winter. You know, we need to think about adding insulation to, we need to protect or upgrade the light fixtures. That's a good opportunity. I think we need to think about a vapor barrier at the insulation. All the work
is going to require a lot of scaffolding because of the size of that thing. And it's important that when we're working up there, we don't damage the existing roof. We could coat the exterior with some sort of paint and finish, Turncoat or something that Bob recommended here. But there's a lot of prep work to do in that. I mentioned the HVAC stuff, and I also talked some about the weight of the insulation on top of the acoustical, the existing acoustical ceiling, the gaps in insulation at the light fixtures, the need for a vapor barrier. One of the things that the designer that I brought up to look at it suggested what he thought we would be a really good solution up there is to put a plywood deck at the structural steel 3 or 4 feet above the acoustical ceiling. Remove the insulation at the acoustical ceiling, redo the acoustical ceilings, redo the lighting, and then insulate on top of that deck. And then we could get a continuous vapor barrier. We could get a good insulation that didn't have an issue with the light fixtures. And we'd have a safe place for people to work and walk up there.
Could you?
My question is, what about the structural integrity of putting that plywood deck in?
It's something I think we should evaluate, but it's a lot. It's putting the deck at the top of that steel as opposed to putting all that insulation on top of the acoustical ceiling is a lot better.
But I'm just wondering, structurally wise, whether the weight.
It's absolutely, those kind of questions are why I recommend we don't just do this with a bunch of contractors. We get a designer involved that can help us calculate those kinds of things.
The other thing is, my question is, will you put in rigid insulation in rather than fiberglass?
That might be a really good solution. That would probably be a cost calculation, but yeah, it might be a good solution too. So far, I've been up there with a company called Architectural Roof Management, who's done a ton of roofing work for us. They're very good people. And I've been up there with CNH Architects, they're a firm that does a lot of envelope work. They're located in Amherst. They came to me very highly recommended by a project manager that used to work for me at Smith College. They've done a lot of work there. Can we kind of scroll up? What I've tried to do is put some numbers in that just to give us an idea and a range of what that could be. And you could see, you know, there's a range of $31,000 to $180,000 for the costs, depending on how you put them together. Either way, they're above $25,000, which is going to require us to do a state bid. If you're going to do a project like that, you're going to stick a contingency in there, and I think you should have some design work. So if I was to take my best guess, I would guess this project, you know, when we kind of go through it and select the things we do and don't want to do, is going to end up being in the range of $150,000 to $175,000. The last discussion I had late this afternoon before I came here with the fellow from CNH Architects is, okay, once I show these people tonight what all these options are, they're going to want to know what's the next step, what to do. And he said that he felt for somewhere around $6,000, they could come in and do the calculations, things about the roof, and do a budget for us and lay the project out so we could have a project to decide on, and we would have a better budget to try to fund for, and then we'd have to make a decision. I would still recommend after that we have someone actually do the final design for us so that we had something that we could, but part of his budget, if we spend that $6,000 to have him do a good budget, he'll show us those costs.
But he's not going to be able to give us stamped plans.
No, not the $6,000. He's not going to give us stamped plans for $6,000.
But if he does give to do stamped plans,
would he be able to do that, or do we have to go out to somebody else for it?
Well, what he could give us stamp plan. But what he recommended that we do is, after he does the initial study, that he team up, he recommended another firm that I'm familiar with in the area, Dietz Associates, because they're much more familiar with the state bidding process. And he said it's really good to have a firm that has some real good experience with state bidding and school work.
Because this isn't the state bidding where we're going to ask the school building assistance people for a dollar.
Well, this is...
Well, I don't think this is going
to... I'm trying to stay away from the $6 million rule.
Yeah, we're not. No, what we're I think we're working at a project that's going to be below the $250,000 threshold that would even allow us to make an application.
I just want to make
sure. Is that the threshold for the accelerated repair program, is 250?
My understanding is, yes,
it is 250.
It has to be in excess of
250. So, did he have a guesstimate of what his stamp plans would cost us?
Well,
the design?
The worst case scenario, if we did a project that was $240,000, then I would say a 15% design allowance on that would be $31,000. And 15% is generous.
Okay.
And $240,000 is high. So what I would say to you is the final design would probably be somewhere around $10,000 to $15,000 to do a really good job.
Over and above the six we're going to.
That's correct.
The reason I ask is we're now not going to vote on the $5,500
right.
for the net metering credit, so.
I'm going to turn the line out. Please.
Thank you.
Yeah.
We wouldn't have voted that money for something else.
Yeah.
So
well, that's got to come from somewhere.
Warner can, yeah, I know, but at least it's not. We're not doing both.
Penny told me she found where we could find the $15,000 that we talked about doing 2 weeks ago, right?
I can't
she
say thank you enough for what you've
where
done.
We could transfer.
Yeah, here, absolutely.
The intensity of what you've done and the time and the effort that you've put into this and the questions that we keep asking you and keep bringing you back, this is just incredible. And thank you very much.
Leaves you with a warm and fuzzy feeling.
Well, and leaves me very like,
I just want to bring it, you know, Bob, when Bob and I talked a couple weeks ago, he did have a visitor that go up on the roof with him and up in that area, which was a selectman from Deerfield. So he's given Bob his opinion on what to do up there as a selectman and stuff, and knowing a little bit about the building.
He's also
trades.
A contractor, don't forget.
I'm just trying to bring it to your attention that when we start talking $200,000 or thereabouts, I'm just saying we're gonna have some flack on it.
Well, we're not gonna have as much flack as what happened on the elementary school roof. Is the money that went into the design and all the soft costs because you got your state grants and all that, there was so much fluff put into the whole cost.
Those are the trappings of the accelerated repair program,
yeah.
Because the state comes in and does the analysis, they do the engineering, and you
lose
what they tell you to use.
And you lose
and you got bullied by the contractor.
Okay, so we're not going to be doing that this time, so on the road.
Well, we're trying to stay away from it.
I personally think that just with everything you've shown us and everything, I feel very secured that this is in your hands. I was going to ask you of those two groups that you had listed here, who you felt better working with. I know we would have to go out to bid, you said?
Yeah, basically,
architectural
roof
things?
Management is they're a contractor. They, if we bid this project, they'd be one of the bidders.
They would be
bidding. The work.
Okay.
CNH Architects is Tom Hartman. I would like to take the $6,000 and just go to them. I think, you know, if we can do that under the sound business practices, they're good
mm-hmm.
people, and I know they're going to give us a good, honest perspective on what it is. They even said that if the project gets bigger, they may want to team with someone like Dietz and Company Architects because they're more familiar with the state bidding process.
Mm-hmm.
But for a real practical nuts and bolts, and these people, you know, they came up a week ago. And he spent
the better part of a day here with me and sent me a 5-page memo which outlined a bunch of the things that I put in here, and they didn't charge me anything for it. They didn't give us any real estimates, but you know, it's a big expectation for us to ask somebody to. I did get from the people, architectural roof management, you know, he gave me a price, and in defense of him, even though in the end we may decide not to paint that, he gave me a price because I asked him for it. He actually went out, looked at the different products, and gave me a price of $54,000 to paint that. We may, once we take a better solid look at that, decide that we're not going to paint it. I think it's really important, if we decide not to paint it, that we're very clear with everybody involved, because it's going to be a little nerve-wracking to me to spend, you know, a good chunk of money on that roof and leave it looking the way it does, because people are going to say, oh my God, didn't you just spend all that money? Why does it look that way?
Well, plus the painting you're going to do, depending on the product and stuff, between caulking and the primer you're using, the paint's going to fill a lot of those gaps that you see air or the wind-driven rain's going to be. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's the biggest thing. I mean, you could probably go up there at nighttime and put a light, a high bright light in there, and start marking where those spots.
It works better just the opposite. It's dark here. So if you go in there when it's really light outside.
So you can start, I'm just saying, if you had a marker from the outside, and you could at least see them and stuff. So.
Can you give you any sort of guesses on time frame for the architectural part of this? How long is it? Would you need to pull it off?
Well, I would like to allow at least maybe two meetings from now before we. Because a lot of what's going to hold us up now is the weather. I was really lucky when I got all these pictures and stuff that it was a little slippery and icy up there, but it wasn't.
Yes, I'm just thinking in terms of the town meetings are coming.
Yeah, so
so I'm trying.
It's going to take a while. I would hesitate, and it might be weather dependent. But I would say, I don't know how it falls into the town meeting structure, but if I had another until maybe it's February now, sometime in late March, probably I could hopefully have their report back.
That's one meeting.
Yeah, no, I don't know.
We would have it for April.
I don't know when the first warrant closes. That's where I'm going with this. If you want action to take place at the annual town meeting.
Part of me wants to get you the information as quick as I can. Part of me wants to be really sure I give you the right information. And although we've got all of these leaks, I'd rather lose a year and do it right than get you information right now and do a project that's not 100%. I'll push to get the information as quickly as I can, and I'll let Lynn know, and if I can have it for the next meeting, I'll be here with you.
And I would just, I heard what you said, that there's a lot of good reasons that this should be the, I mean, we don't know about next year. This year is... it's never good, but this year is like
good year.
Yeah, do it this year.
From a financial standpoint, this is not a bad time to approach this thing, because the assessments aren't bad, the budget isn't bad, you know, in pretty good shape. I don't know how the towns are fiscally, but we're in pretty good shape here, so that's the only reason that I ask those kinds of questions.
Keith?
Well, can you just walk me step by step through these? So the first one, the caulk paint, sealant finish, that one is aesthetic, although it might help to fill the gaps, but it's not an absolutely...
That's right. That's a real tough one to decide, because you're right. I'm hearing that even though that looks awful up there, there's no deterioration of the material itself.
Okay. And the clear story window, you need to replace.
Yes. Okay. Well, it's not a replace. Yes, again. Basically, there's two different prices. There's two different prices on that repair. The first price is to fix the gasketing material, leaving the glass where it is, and that's not the best solution, because you're not sure about it, the material sticking well. The higher price, which is I think still pretty reasonable, is to bring a crane in there, hold the glass, clean the slots that the glass goes into, and reset everything. It'd be like new, but it'd be reuse the existing glass.
Okay. With a warranty, you told me too. Versus the other one, there wouldn't be a warranty.
They said they can't guarantee
right.
it.
And again, the second part of it looks at the envelope, so you're fixing the envelope, not just...
Yes. And I can't stress, I hesitate. I've been, you know, in this last week, we've had some severe weather, and there's three schools that have had their roofs done in the time that I've been here. Conway, Waitley, and now Deerfield. The roofs in Conway and Deerfield were done with some design work. They were done very well. The people that designed them were cognizant of the envelopes. I have no ice damming, no ice, no problems at all. Waitley's okay metal roof, but there was no thought. It was just a contract. A contractor was hired to come in there and do it. There was no design involved in that. And if you go there and look at it now, there's huge, even though that's a metal roof that the snow slides off pretty good, there's a ton of ice damming there because we didn't look at the whole structure. And I think it's very important when we do this roof, we look at the whole structure.
The upper flashing and lower flashing cost below that, would that be rolled into if we brought the crane in to take the windows out?
I would recommend doing the higher price on both of that upper and lower flashing.
Okay.
Very strongly, because they're not huge amounts of money.
Yep. And then the cricket above the clear storage. Insulation, you were questioning, but then the vapor barrier, it seemed like you said that.
Well, I would like the opinion of a designer. I think there ought to be a vapor barrier there. I'm sure there isn't one.
Okay. Third to last one, the plywood deck is what you're recommending, but that's not necessarily 100%, it's not a need. And then the access to the roof sounded like a good idea as well.
The access to the roof is very inexpensive, mm-hmm. and well worth doing, but it's not needed. It's not, to me, it's a safety thing. And that plywood deck is a safety thing for people working up there, and it's also a safety thing in that I don't like the fact that we've got the weight of that insulation on top of the acoustical ceiling.
You said that was a safety thing, the plywood deck. If I remember, you said it make things easier to access and safer.
It's going to make it safer for people
who
work up there.
Who wants to put safety last?
Move around.
I think we need to put that one on top.
Yeah.
You can also with the insulation.
Pardon me?
Would that affect the type of insulation you would use? Is that what that
Well, be? I don't know. We can still use either a rigid or a fiberglass insulation. But we can put insulation in and very nicely get it continuous.
But it would be on top of the plywood instead of on top of the acoustical ceiling.
That's right. And another thing that we would probably do if we built that plywood deck is that air handler that I showed you up there. We could, just in the area of the air handler, we could extend the plywood deck up a little higher and encase that in a warmer space that would just make it much more efficient to heat and air condition. Mm-hmm. And it would protect the coils of the unit. This is a lot of positives.
Okay. The HVAC, I think, is a necessity. And then just the last one, the LED lighting, was that a 100% need?
It isn't. But if we go in there and take all, you know, if we do the plywood deck, we're probably going to take the acoustical ceiling down. If we take the acoustical ceiling down, we're going to go through all of the labor of putting new lights up and down. So the only cost associated with new lighting would be the purchase of the lighting, and then we'd probably get a rebate from the power company on the cost of it. So in my opinion, it's kind of a no-brainer.
We burn natural gas, don't we?
Yes.
And what about any sort of a kickback from the natural gas company?
Possible. If we have a designer doing this, we'll have him run it through both.
We'll shoot every tree looking for some money to follow.
Okay. Well, I think we ought to authorize the $5,000 or $6,000 tonight if it's legal to do it.
Is that a motion?
Yes.
For six?
Is that what it costs, Bob? Six?
Well, Not to exceed six.
Under $6,000 to
Lynn?
Do it.
My question, and correct me if I'm wrong, did we agree the last meeting for $15,000 or did we to?
Well, we were trying to find where we were going to find the money. And he wanted the range,
right?
And we said Patty was going to look
twice on the same.
Yeah, we would be, but it's already approved. You're right.
I'm just wondering
because we did approve not to exceed $15,000.
Yep. Yep. Yeah, but we approved that, but we haven't approved hiring a certain person.
Okay.
No, the 15 was to not exceed $15,000 for a study and to revisit this item in February. So it is for a study.
Okay.
So is that some? thing that, like, okay, are we revoting it, so?
I can, based on that vote, I can do the project, I can get somebody.
You have the money up to $15,000 to do what you need to do.
Okay.
And again, thank you.
This is the year.
Patty said that money that I found in the budget, you know, was available.
This is the year.
Yes, okay.
And I know Bob will get the best price for any kind of.
I'll give as much of a priority as I can to move on this as quickly as I can.
You got a vote on that, on the approve the long range facility plan, are we doing anything with that for a vote?
I don't think.
Premature at this point.
I think that he's coming back, he's gonna try to come back with a timeline, yeah.
I don't think we should have it on here again, because this will be the third time we've tabled this, so we should probably keep it off until we're ready.
Okay.
Do you agree on that?
No, I think it should go back on if Bob has that information, I think it was it available and what?
But we're not gonna have it until April, right?
No, it might be next month, you said.
Part of the long range plan was the stair treads, the clear story windows, certain things like that, and so we're pulling some of that off for the roof thing. But the other things like the stair treads, and I'm trying to remember, do you remember what else was on that 5-year plan? Or this, for the 1-year?
If we put it on our agenda, we don't have to vote on it, if we don't have it on our agenda, we can't vote on it.
So we're gonna, just gonna table?
So it's crazy, I just assume keep tabling, which proves tabled things do come back. It's really kind of weird. So we're gonna table that again, you're gonna see what you can do yet again for us. But you have the $15,000, yes, Principal?
I came in late, I'm sorry, I was at the 8th grade meeting there. Are we also looking at recarpeting that? Would it be prudent to recarpet at that time, at the end of that project, after we do the whole ceiling and that kind of thing?
Yes.
I didn't know if we could get that number added in there, because I'm thinking, if you're thinking of the space in your head, as soon as we seal that up, replace the ceiling, that carpet, which is now in terrible shape, is going to look really terrible, and might as well just do it all at that point. Because I imagine we're moving all the books and all that kind of stuff when they're working on the ceiling above it, so.
And it's, something you and I really need to talk about is, you know, do we want to try to just take that money and get the most we can by doing it ourselves, or do we want to wrap it in this project so that it gets coordinated and all happens in a thoughtful way, so.
Right, I just wanted to.
There's pluses and minuses to doing that, but we need to talk about it.
Right, we're getting a little wiggy on.
We just want to stay away from the school building assistance people.
Okay, so we have tabled, and are you good to go? Does anybody have any questions before we let Bob go? Again, yeah, still. Thank you, sir.
All right.
I know way too much about this now. Okay, moving along, we have way too many jumps here. So we are up to new business B, formulation of a sick leave bank committee for Unit A. I have no clue, is that, Superintendent, are you gonna speak to that?
I'm going to defer to Principal Modesto for that.
Principal Modesto, would you speak to that?
Basically, you created a, following the contract, someone's requested sick bank, to create a sick bank now from Unit A, you had it before you did Unit C. And so the question is, the same people that we can go to again, or do you want to reassign somebody again, or do you just want to reassign, you want to assign two people for the entire year, and just make that an annual group, and if it's, it just hasn't been done, I've been here 9 years, it's the first time I think it's come up, maybe it was done my first year here, but so, it hasn't, maybe we just haven't had two in this year coming out of two different units. And so the question is it the same two people who did the first one, or do we elect something new, but we need to, I need two members to,
but the.
Someone has requested sick leave bank, I need two representatives from the school.
I make a motion to make the same two people do it again.
Does that make sense?
Do I have a second?
Second.
Do I have any other discussion? Remember who those two people are.
Winning myself.
There's a good question, would you like, a different people?
It has nothing to do with me, you meet with the union reps.
Oh, okay. So, did you find that, the people, you did it and you did it, right? Did you find that a comfortable?
No, it wasn't me.
Oh, I'm sorry, who was it, was Len?
Len.
Oh, it was Bob.
The question is, they did not want to move forward to actually establishing a formal bank with a whole set of procedures.
Right.
And I'm not sure what the union is requesting on the other bargaining unit.
I've seen how it's working in here.
Okay.
Here's my nod.
All right, so I don't know what they want, but they like, the people who were involved liked the informal way that it was done, and in my opinion, but...
So the new, this is...
Union rep.
Union rep, who, this is all... What did you guys want to do?
Case by case, people applying to have relief from the sick bank for sick time that they have gone past what they had on ASOP on the record. We've had a request for some time, and we need to have two union representatives and two school committee representatives to hear their request and to approve it or not, and then the union asks membership for time after.
All right, so basically, I think basically similar to what was done before.
So you were comfortable, were you involved in the last one? Was the union comfortable with how we, the people that we sent and how it was handled then? Okay,
yes.
So
yes.
Are you still willing to do it then?
Sure.
And Bob?
I'll do it.
Okay, so we've got a motion, we've got a second, all those in favor?
Amen.
Did you vote yes?
I did.
Okay.
Unanimous.
Thank you very much.
I got all that too, just to let you know.
Okay. I really appreciate
Again,
that.
You're jumping a lot.
I am.
You are.
You get the big bucks for. Do you
this
want
morning
to
when I got up, everything was in line. By the time I got here, I was jumping.
Have we done anything with the 5,500?
We nixed that.
That's gone.
We nixed
that. Bob withdrew that request.
Bob requested Bob would, us. He requested that back in unfinished business so there wouldn't be a vote.
His advisor told him that the market being what it is, it's not worth doing at this point. So he doesn't want to pursue it.
But you'll keep in touch.
My gosh, Bob, you're signing. Okay, lastly, under new business, we have building exploration subcommittee, and I know, Lynn, you're going to speak to that.
I'm requesting the school committee to allow us to put together the, I'm printing the 5-year plan. I'm going to give everyone a copy of your own so that next time we come to talk about it, we'll know what we're looking at. We need an auto scrubber, something else. So anyway, I'm requesting the school committee to give permission to
reconstitute
the building subcommittee to look at the central office building subcommittee, the team that we had together to help us search out where to move and to help us as we facilitated the move, incidentally, which went seamlessly. And thanks to Darius, Bob, people working, everything just really melded together beautifully. Maybe, two or three days lost work. I mean, it was inconvenient for, I think, the bookkeepers a little bit, but everybody's fine. We're back on track, and it was a great move.
You have an empty building.
We have an empty building now, and we need to really consider many of the questions asked when we were moving. What are you going to do with Whately? It's not me, it's us, and I'd like to have that building subcommittee back together and anyone else who wants to be on it. We were meeting on Tuesdays at 8:30 in the morning. It's Bob's day off. Bob was on the committee, Phil, Bob Decker.
And Bob, two Bobs.
Right.
Yep.
But I would invite
Bob and Phil show.
Yeah, I
Stay
would
tuned.
Invite anyone else to be on it because, to be honest with you, Bob Decker has been doing some research and there's some items we need to talk about that it may be complicating the situation with the building. We do own the land. We own a portion of we thought at one point we only owned the building, but we do own the land. But by owning the land, there's a couple of things that we need, to look at. Oil tanks and this sort of thing.
Okay. So, can I have a motion?
Pass the motion.
After a motion and a second?
I have a motion. I'll motion.
Thank you.
Yep.
Second? Now you may.
How long
Who made the second?
Bill.
Me.
Billy. Go ahead. What was the question again?
How long do the meetings usually last? Tuesdays, 8:30. So.
It depends. It depends how
Bob.
Talkative Bob feels.
Or how many cookies that Lynn brings.
Yeah.
11 o'clock, probably.
Yeah, but we try. We yeah.
An hour.
Yeah.
We have
You're very welcome in your perspective.
There were many meetings before I came on board, and so my piece with the building subcommittee was, we know we're moving, we've done all that work, where are we gonna go? And then it became quite clear that we didn't want to invest money in land that we would never own. We wanted to invest money in this building. And incidentally, we came out, right now we have $35,000 in the move. At one point we had, to be, you know, conservative, we had estimated we would spend a lot more, but we didn't. So it worked out really well. So I would say an hour and a half. What we need to do is look at the deed that Bob has given us, he's found for us, and talk about some of the complications. And also, too, you know, the town of Waitley is involved, and they have, you know, first rights.
Judy, would you like to be on the committee?
That would give some of them some representation.
Yeah, I'm happy to, you've got to commit to no, I got to walk out the door at 9:45.
Okay.
But if you guys can commit to that, then yeah, I can work my schedule around it.
So we can amend the motion that the meeting will go from 8:30 to 9:45.
Well, we can actually start.
I can start at 8.
We can start earlier.
We start at 8. Now that we're here, we're dropping the kids off at 8.
You get up early enough or what?
Yes, I will. Yeah. Definitely we can do 8 o'clock.
Are we going to meet there?
Yeah, my office is.
We'll let you all work that out.
Are we going to get first in line while we're talking about it?
We should vote you on to the committee.
I would like to start. We get to meet at Christian Lane.
I mean, what do you think?
Is the heat on?
It's not an attractive place now. It is really shabby. Once they moved everything out.
We're going to have to go there eventually.
It's
maybe
really
when it gets
shabby.
Warmer.
Okay, so we have a motion and we have a second, and so I will clarify that we want Bob, Phil, and Judy on that committee.
Bob Duffy as well.
Bob, Phil,
yeah, Bob
and Judy. The Bob, Phil, and Judy show.
Yeah, and Mr.
Oh my
Smith,
gosh.
He's available.
Do you want to get into it? Do you want to be on the committee? It's just a question. You don't have to yell. I can see it coming.
It worked.
His name
okay,
is
we'll move along. Bill does not want to be on the committee. He may visit.
His name is on the acceptance of the building.
Yes,
let me slog my way through the budget first.
100 years ago.
I mean, we did the bathroom. Did you sign the paperwork?
I went to school there.
I know.
Oh,
okay,
man.
So all those in favor?
I already wrote down
unanimous.
That. I did there.
You already wrote it down.
I went to elementary school in that building.
All right. I will email everyone and set up a Tuesday in
3, 4, 5, and 6.
I think personally it's important that we have a meeting there. Even if it's
okay.
The first one, I think that's where we need to be.
All right.
That's what we're talking about. We can see what we need to do. You mentioned bringing a scrapper in to get at least get the metal out of there. That's one thing we could do, you know, while we talk the first meeting and stuff like that. And
we
then
pick the targets on for the Scud missile.
Okay, so you can have that discussion on your own. Moving on to reports. Now I'm in order, Bob, just so you know.
Oh, thanks.
I have nothing, so collaborative.
Yep, got a few things. Bill Deal, the executive director, would like to visit each district, and so he would like 15 minutes of our time. So I just need to give him dates that would work for him and for you.
What do you think?
Are we still going to meet the 28th?
After budget season.
I think after budget season, maybe April?
Yeah, we should.
The April meeting, because we have to vote a final budget in March. We have a meeting set up. April 28th is we're going to be meeting that. Like, it looks like.
Yeah, Judy's got a good point. Is that the joint meeting? He can kill a lot of birds with one stone.
April, that's right. That's the joint meeting. April 24th, I think.
He can get five. He can get five elementaries at
it's
one.
It's a Thursday night.
Okay.
And Frontier all at the same time.
Are you going to come that night?
All right, I'll tell him.
I've been on a roll. I've been like the last 3 or 4 in a row. Just
doing
the check. Except for the one when I showed up on
the
wrong
night.
So the April meeting. Is everybody good with the April meeting for?
He said it'd be like 2 minutes. It's just kind of a meet and greet.
Lynn, do you have the date of the joint meeting on your calendar?
I'll get it for you.
It's a Thursday.
You're gonna do it to me again. I'll be up for Tuesday. There won't be anybody here.
No, it's a Thursday night.
I'm
walking around here.
I've got it right here. The joint school committee is.
I know, drum roll.
Thomas Jefferson's birthday is on the 13th, but the Joint School Committee meeting is on the 6th. It's April 6th.
Oh, it's the first Thursday of the month.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I will probably have my entry plan, that kind of stuff for you.
Okay, so 15 minutes, and then he can hit everybody at one time.
Thank you. Now I know Thomas Jefferson's birthday.
I think that sounds good.
I was wondering.
Okay, so thank
I'll
you.
See if that works for him.
And that would be great. Okay. And again, he would avoid having 5 meetings.
Right.
So
we're over to one. They've also been really, not pushing isn't the right word, advertising their overhaul of their website. So they want to encourage folks to go to collaborative.org. They can get information on Hack Academy, professional development, things like Special Olympics, and all sorts of really good stuff. They have a big professional development for principals, curriculum leaders, and teachers called Educational Equality and Personalized Learning Institute, April of 2017. I don't know the date of that yet, though.
Lynn, are all the elementary committees involved with the collaborative? Because that wouldn't be an appropriate place to bring him if they're not.
Oh, they are.
They are. All four towns are.
Conway's is.
I thought they were. It's by school.
I don't know. If
Conway is. I know that. I don't know about the other towns.
They are?
We all show up.
Every school committee, yes, there's a collaborative report.
I know, Waitley, we definitely are.
Yeah. And Sunderland is Michelle.
Good question.
So, yeah, so he would definitely kill many birds.
One meeting.
At one time. Not 5 meetings.
Right. Got it.
Right, birds with one stone.
And as a side note, the Mass Rural School Coalition and the Mass Rural Community Summit have been rescheduled to March 7th, 5 to 6 o'clock.
At Mohawk.
At Mohawk.
Yeah. And I will attend that.
The, not to be out of order a little bit, but there's things tomorrow night at the Delaney House on the foundation budget stuff that the School Community Association is putting on. I can't make it, so I've got another meeting to go to. But somebody might want to go to that.
Is that the other person telling you not to go to it?
No, I think it's my son still trying to reach me.
I took two Conway selectmen. I went to the same meeting couple of weeks ago, and I took two Conway selectmen, and I do have a PowerPoint from that meeting, so that was presented by the MASC.
They're going to do another one down the eastern part of the state next month on the same type of thing, but this one's current, so I want to, just rock on.
Anything else,
then? That's it.
Thank you very much. Good amount. Principal's report. You came back just in time.
I do have
principal's report.
Principal's report.
Principal's principal enrollment. I was going to do that for his principal report because he wasn't here, but he's also got some more things up his sleeve. So
we can do a combined. I can put a slash there.
There's his report.
He did want us to approve the money for the police officer, I hope.
So, I mean, my report's straightforward, it's kind of be true. And then I also, sorry, I'm losing my voice. I just got finished the AP, the AP was a couple minutes ago. Information. I just got through the 8th grade information, 8th grade to high school, including high schoolers. And then the next thing on my list was Washington D.C. trip is with Dr. Next, and then annual health survey was done this week, as you guys have approved in the past. And then the last thing is I gave you the letter that you didn't receive at your home regarding Scott Dredge's letter to parents regarding vaping being a new trend that we're seeing amongst teens, and we really want to bring parents' attentions because it's not something you see every day, and it's a whole different. Whole different way of smoking, so to speak. And so it's not something we saw growing up. And so the idea you walk into a room and you smell bubble gum in an exorbitant amount, there's a good chance you have some vaping going on. And so it's not things that within smoking these things, you can add small amounts of drops of different oils to cause different reactions, such as chemicals found in marijuana or worse. So we wanted to bring it to parents' attention. We've seen it. It's in our community. It's in all Franklin County. And we want to bring it up. So that's the only kind of thing that's new other than all the other stuff we've been talking about. That's my report. Any questions?
How did it go tonight?
It was great. We had a good turnout, especially for, I thought, for our reschedule. We always worry. We probably had, let's see, about 40 to 50 people there, so, you know, possibly 25 or so families. You figure how many people already have students have gone through that don't come. So
right.
I thought it was a pretty good turnout.
Excellent. Anyone have any questions?
You have any vibes on how many kids are going to have next year? How many are going to go off to charters and take school?
I don't have any of those numbers yet. We'll get, when I get those, I'll pass those along. We haven't, I don't think they've even, families have even made the decision. I have the sixth grade parent night. I did a copy that got postponed and moved and had low turnout. The first, I had to do two copies, as you remember. The first one usually is low turnout. This is really low. And then I have the parent night for Tuesday. We come back. I don't remember my head right. We come back on vacation is the sixth grade information night. And then I have another copy after that. Learning more about the school. So those things are coming up. It's really early to know who's committing to go where. They even, you know, they started filling out applications right now for the most part. Private's a little bit ahead of us, but the charters are filling out applications.
Have you considered taking that on the road and going to the four elementary schools?
We've actually sent our guidance director to talk to all four.
No, I mean them, I mean you. Don't they want to talk to you?
Who?
The parents?
Yes.
Having a coffee night with the parents at the four different town elementary schools. Okay. This is all taped, just so you know. We'll be out there.
All right.
I just think it would be a phenomenal situation where more, I mean, think about it, Conway. Conway people are going to go to Conway Elementary, but to come down here, I may not do that. Right. But I might go to the elementary school to see you because it's not that far. Just a thought. No pressure. No pressure.
It's just four extra nights.
Four extra.
Yeah. You could do it all one night. You drink.
I'll call your wife and say.
You could do it on finance committee.
That's right.
The thing is, when they do come down here, we do tours of the building and that kind of thing, so they get to see what they're.
You're not getting out of it. They don't need tours. The kids need the tours.
She's going to ask you about the road show. So.
There you go. So thank you, anyway.
Yep.
Superintendent?
Incidentally, Darius is here and he has keys. If there's anyone that would like to see the facilities of the new office after this meeting, we would. Okay. I have a key to my office in the bathroom, but Darius has the keys to all the other rooms.
Someday you'll get the rest of the keys.
Yeah, you know that.
We know you can trust you.
People come to me, I don't tell you. So my report, again, here, I'll just pass it along this way. You can read it. It is also on the webpage under the superintendent's message. And it's essentially what I'm doing is talking about the what the other superintendents through the collaborative, the other superintendents in this area, Hampden, Franklin County, were talking about the new immigration laws. There's a lot of different, every day it changes, and the different immigrations. But essentially, what we want our students and staff to know is that. We feel fortunate to be living so close to several colleges and universities where we can benefit from a wide range of perspectives, experiences, and backgrounds that are drawn to this area. At Frontier Regional and Union 38 schools, we believe diversity in our students and staff makes our schools stronger and richer while preparing all of our children to develop the skills needed to live and work in the global marketplace. We will continue to serve every child living in our district who chooses to attend our schools, regardless of his or her immigration status. We will work with the Department of Justice, the Department of Education, and the Supreme Court, using their guidance as they guide us towards understanding that students cannot be denied a free public education on account of immigration status. So we want our families, all of them, to feel welcome, and we're pleased to have them in our district, and there's no there's no fear, there should be no fear with our accepting of that, so.
So if this is an issue that's important to you, have you thought about taking it just a little bit further, like Amherst and Hamp did, about becoming a sanctuary school and formally declaring as such?
Amherst, this came from the collaborative through Northampton. John Provost, superintendent of Amherst School, John Provost, superintendent of Northampton Schools, they came up with this this narrative, which I've done, and then, of course, I've added to it. But at this point, I don't see anyone in any danger in Frontier or the Union Schools, and I would move further on it if any of the things were warranted. But right now, I think that just understanding that we're following the Department of Justice, we're following the Supreme Court, we're following the Department of Education on this, and things do keep changing.
Very shortly, we may not want to follow either any of those on this.
So thank you. Moving along.
Yes.
That's all I have for tonight.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. All opinions are welcome. Okay, can you get anything else quickly?
Saturday, March 11th, fundraiser for the 250th at Conway, the trivia night where I am writing the questions. Conway Inn, 7 p.m., pizza, beer, and trivia. What more could you ask for?
At the elementary school?
At Conway Inn.
Okay.
Saturday, March 11th.
I was trying to catch it.
I'm apologizing in advance for questions.
All those
find
in
disturbing.
Favor? I apologize in advance for the questions.
So just let me know.
Thank you. We've adjourned. You may close down.
Hey,
poor thing.
Bill.
Thank you.
Hey, Bob. So,